The prices, I'm sure there will be more thorough introduction to that on Thursday. So I'm just going to mention what's this year's Watson Medal from the National Academy of Sciences. And then that Evine is also the president elect of the IAU, I think, with a transition happening later this year or next year.
Right, but still, it'll be very busy.
Yeah, I bet. So thank you so much, Evine, for being here. And please, we're excited to hear what we'll have to say.
Okay, good. Thanks very much, Karen, and thanks very much, Jose, for inviting me. There you are. I'm sorry, I was looking at it. For inviting me and to everybody here for making it possible. It's great to see so many of you here, so many familiar faces. I'm truly honored to be here, and especially honored to honor Alex and remember him also through this series of lectures. So as the lectures go along, I will say a little bit more also about Alex. Let me just see if I have this too. Yes. Okay. About Alex, I really like this photo, which was actually taken in Leiden when he was our art professor at the time. And yeah, to me this is really well how Alex has looked like. And just one of the many quotes that there are about Alex is that there was no greater figure than Alex Albano in the history of atomic physics and its application. To me, also one of the other great heroes of atomic and molecular physics, which was Sir David Binns. But it is really this combination of the deep, deep knowledge of the atomic and molecular processes that Alex had, together with its applications, that made him really so great. And in this series of lectures, I hope to give you some examples of that, as to the detailed interplay that we have between the knowledge of atomic and molecular physics and, on the other hand, the applications, and that the one can really not do without the other, that I hope to show you through a number of examples. So today I'm actually going to focus on photon-induced processes, mostly photodissociation, because that's the area that Alex and I worked on the most together. And that's also an area that used to be, and still is actually, a topic of active research in ITEMP, which is my host here during this series of lectures. Even though it's not sort of now at the cutting edge of ultra-cold collisions and everything that is happening these days in atomic physics, I think it's still a process that is very much important for everything we do in astronomy. In fact, it keeps amazing me how every time we think we are done and understand everything, something new pops up and we have to say, oh yes, we have to go back and recalculate that particular process. Okay, so I see a number of people in the audience who are clear experts in this area. I see other people who are probably not so much experts. So I'll go with a few introductory slides, especially if you're not an astronomer. This is where we find interstellar molecules in the more dense and shielded regions of the interstellar medium, the clouds, as we call them, the denser concentrations of the interstellar gas. But even in the more diffuse gas, we see molecules. Simple molecules, but sometimes also even the sturdy molecules that are so big that they can actually resist the UV radiation and survive sort of their destructions. Our laboratory is a very good laboratory, actually, a very interesting laboratory. We have densities of the order of a few hundred cubic centimeters in these diffuse clouds, and the dense clouds, when an astronomer talks about the dense clouds, it's of the order of, say, 10,000 particles per cubic centimeter. But that's, of course, still much, much less than what you have in a laboratory here on Earth, where in an ultra-high vacuum, you still have of the order of, say, 10 to the 8, if you're lucky, particles per cubic centimeter. So that's sort of the regimes that we're talking about. And actually, UV radiation turns out to be one of the dominant destructions of molecules, as long as your amount of extinction is less than, say, a few magnitudes. Now, we find UV photons everywhere in astronomy. We started out with these diffuse clouds. This is a nice image of the Zeta Elf cloud, one of Alex's favorite targets to study. Dense clouds is in Orion. Here we have the Orion Bar, so-called photon-dominated regions, photodissociation regions. Actually, it was Alex who coined the term photon-dominated regions, because he didn't like the term photodissociation regions, because the photons are doing more than just dissociating them. They are also doing, for example, the heating. Dark cloud. The term dark suggests that there are no UV photons there. And that's true, there are not many UV photons there, but there is a weak radiation field induced by the cosmic rays interacting with molecular hydrogen that creates actually UV photons deep inside the cloud. And that is actually also inducing quite some chemistry. These days, protoplanetary disks, very active topic of research. And of course, they are irradiated by the field from the star, and that is both heating and dissociating the molecules in the surface layers. Also, the jets, and the jets are outflows. You see already they are very much irradiated. That's where the UV photons are important. Comets. Topic that Alex also worked on very actively is an area where the sun actually dissociates the molecules. Exoplanets, not yet very popular or topical in the time of that Alex was active, but he did work a lot of planetary atmospheres. And of course, there is where he also appreciated already the importance of photodissociation. And now it's becoming very important again, the hot Jupiters that are close to their parent star, where actually the radiation is dissociating the molecules, and you can actually see that. And then finally, even when we go to evolved stars, then the central star, of course, can get very hot when you go towards the planetary nebula stage, and that is also dissociating the molecules. So you see that everywhere. Sort of in astrophysics, we encounter UV photons, and we need to understand how they are actually interacting with the molecules. So we do this really in an interdisciplinary approach. Of course, the astronomers are doing mostly the observations and building also the instruments to make that possible at various wavelengths. And in terms of molecular astrophysics or astrochemistry, we are working here mostly in the infrared and also millimeter part of the spectrum, where we certainly had a very rich sort of time with various facilities, now of course ALMA. Models, that's also largely astronomers who are doing that kinetic models that are trying to explain sort of the molecules that we see through a whole series of reactions, and they can be tailored to dark clouds, to protostars, to disks, to exoplanets. But then here is really where the laboratory, where the chemical physicists sit. And the laboratory, I mean not just the people working in the actual laboratory, but also people working with computers and this theory that are basically studying these basic molecular processes or the spectroscopy that feeds both into the observations and that feeds into the models. And that's chem. There's a huge range of processes that we actually need in order to understand our observations and our models. Spectroscopy is the first item there. We simply need that to identify species in space. But then as soon as we want to derive anything from the light strength, we need collision rates. And then what I'm going to focus on is really the interaction with the UV photons, the photons. But then there's a whole other series of ion molecule reactions, neutral-neutral reactions, grain surface processes, etc. So this is really still very much work that is in progress. I mean, if you think of atomic physics, then it took probably a century of work by the atomic physicists to get to the level that we can now put into to Cloudy or any of the other big programs. And with molecules, we are still, you know, adding another level of complexity, but having there's certainly still a century of work ahead of us, I think, to make all of this possible. So what I'm going to do is focus first on the processes, then on the radiation fields, and then a little bit on the ISIS versus gas, and then I want to end this isotope selective photo dissociation, which is a topic of current, it keeps coming back as also as a topic of interest. Just to remind everybody, if you want to study photo processes, you need to do know two things. You need to know sort of how the what the cross section is, basically for absorption and dissociation of a molecule as a function of wavelength, and you need to know the radiation field. So I'm going to first focus on this part and then on that part. So this is meant to be sort of a lecture also, so I'm going to go through some quite a bit of basics, and then I'll pause at sort of certain stages along this way and invite comments then or questions from the audience so that you don't have to wait for this everything until the very end. Now there's no shortage of reasons actually on this topic. In fact, Kate Kirby and myself wrote one in 1988 for one of the, was it Alex's 60th birthday, I think. And then, what is it? Of course, Alex wrote quite a number of papers himself also. And then most recently, we have, just to land advertisement, is this paper where we sort of reviewed everything, we tried to review everything in the literature on photo dissociation processes together with Alan Hayes. So really, Alan has been, who is also a molecular physicist, has been leading this effort. Good. So, if you're not a molecular physicist, a little bit on what photo dissociation is. Here I have a photon, here I have a molecule, and basically we split it apart. So, if we go down and what this means in terms of the processes, the simplest one is basically you start in the ground state of a molecule here, dielectric molecule, you excite into a repulsive electronic state, and then you dissociate basically on a very fast femtosecond time frame. And basically, what you then get as a cross section is a very broad cross section that basically reflects the vibrational wave function of the in the ground electronic state. So, this, for astrophysical purposes, thanks, this is important. That this is a very broad cross-section, that means that it doesn't saturate very quickly. Now the other way that can go, because the molecule has many excited electronic states, in fact an infinite number that that converge until the Reaper, until the ionization potential, and many of them can also be bound, like the ground state. So you can also excite into one of these bound states, and then have a coupling between these dissociative states, which may be even a different character, a different spin. And that is a process that is known as predissociation. And the important thing here is that you no longer have a very broad cross-section, but you actually have a very structured cross-section that corresponds to initial absorption into these levels, which are basically then broadened by the coupling with the dissociative state, and that is what's called the structure. That's also why the spectroscopy is called this pre-dissociation, because you're seeing the molecules just before they are dissociating. Okay, good. So apart from these two main processes, there is one other very important process that's called spontaneous radio dissociation. Mouthful of words. I think actually Alex is the one who studied that in great detail on molecular hydrogen. It's only important for molecular hydrogen. I've not yet found another molecule for which this is important. Direct photo dissociation dominates, for example, H2 plus, OH, water. Pre-dissociation, very important for two interstellar molecules, CO and molecular hydrogen. And then there are other types of detailed interactions. In fact, one that Alex and I worked on in the 1980s, which is so-called non-adiabatic interactions between excited states. But I won't go into details this lecture here. So let's look at the H2 plus ion. This is one that we can still do analytically, you know. And has been done many, many years ago, of course, but it's still topical. Especially when you realize that this is a process that is especially important in the early universe chemistry that Alex worked a lot on, that a lot of the cross-sections that people were using in that chemistry were just from the lowest vibrational state here in this potential well, and then going up and then this dissociation. People start to realize that in the early universe, the H2 plus was warmer, and that you needed to take into account that some of the higher vibration levels might also be modulated, and that could actually have quite a bit of effect on the early universe hydrogen chemistry. So that is a sort of a new feature that is nicely explained in a review paper by Radhika and Ola, actually. And they used as for their title of their annual reviews paper a term that was coined by Alex, which is called the dawn of chemistry. The early universe chemistry is the dawn of chemistry. Yeah. Okay, good. So that is H2+, and let's now go to the next level of complexity, namely H2. And we see immediately that H2 is very different from H2+. No repulsive excited electronic state. And we just have here these two bound states. This is the first excited electronic states through which dipole and lone transitions are possible. So you go from the ground state all the way to almost more than 11 electron volts before you get into this excited state. And it goes to B state and C state, and then you radiate that ground to the ground state. And in 90% of the cases that you go up, you radiate back into the vibrational continuum of the ground state. 10% you radiate back into the vibrational continuum, and then you dissociate. This is a process that Alex quantified in great detail, studied and quantified in great detail around 1970, and also this Dr. Stevens who was here. And we are still using sort of basically those numbers. They have been improved a little bit, but I think at the 5 to 10% level is what has changed since the 1970s. Okay, now to another molecule. So we go now from H2 to OH. This is the molecule that Alex put me to for my PhD, and he said, why don't you study OH? So the first thing that you have to do then is calculate the potential curves. And at that time, just a couple of them were known. Here, this A state was known. Basically, anything that has a letter, A, B, those were known. And so we used high-level up initial calculations to compute these curves, and then especially the ones that were below 30.6 electron volts, which is the ionization potential of hydrogen. And you see immediately that now we have many different processes that can play a role. Here we have pre-dissociation that plays a role. But we also have direct dissociation into this state, and into this state, and into this state. That was all happening. Here we have an example of this non-adiabatic coupling between the double pi states. This is more for the experts in the audience, which turned out to be a very interesting process, actually, to study from a basic molecular physics point of view. And then here, up there, we get into all of these Rydberg states, that some of them quite large oscillator strength. And then the question is, you know, which of these are really sort of crossed here by one of these dissociative states so that it can actually lead to dissociation? That's the question. I mean, does absorption from here to here lead to dissociation? Or does it simply radiate back to the ground state? This becomes already very complex to calculate. So this is in works, more what we did actually here. You calculate all these potential curves, you calculate the transition dipole moments, which determine the oscillator strengths basically, of these, for all of these curves. Then you try to solve for the Zinder-Bornock-Oppenheimer approximation. You use them to solve for the nuclear motion on these surfaces, taking couplings between the states into account, and then you compute your cross sections as you see. As you see over here. And this actually works quite well if your number of electrons is not too large and if your system is not too complex. So OH was a very good example of doing that, but anything with more
electrons, that's really quite difficult. Accuracy that we determined at the time, and I think that is still sort of holds, which is probably good enough for astronomical applications. You never can get the positions very accurate. I would say 1.2 eV is sort of the accuracy, and oscillator strength of the order of 30%. And the higher you cut up in these potential energy mass, so to say, the more difficult it becomes to calculate all of this mixing. And so that's why dissociation efficiencies are usually assumed to be limited, and that usually sort of upgraded to your rate. So this was possible for small molecules, but the moment you go to larger molecules, anything triatomic or more, it becomes basically impossible to do full potential services and dynamics. We studied some triatomic molecules, water, CH2, NH2, but I think the entire chemical physics community has by now spent several dozen years studying water photodissociation, and still there are details that we do not understand of the water photodissociation. So that tells you just how complex gets. So if you want to sort of at least get some information that is important for the study, then you have to do some shortcuts. So one way to get a shortcut is not to calculate a full potential service or a full potential curve, but simply only to calculate the vertical excitation spectrum, making use of the Frank-Condon principle that, the strongest absorption are basically vertically up into the excited electronic state. And so that's what we did when all of these carbon chain molecules started to be discovered. Of course, here at Harvard, is Pathelius and Mike McCarthy played a very important role in all of these small carbon chain and also larger carbon chain molecules. And we wanted to know really how sturdy they were against photodissociation. So together with Mark van Hemert, we basically computed all of the excited electronic states, the dissociation ion, the g-stim, the ionization potentials, and we basically assumed that all absorptions above the dissociation energy and below the ionization potential lead to dissociation. And so then you can get things like this. These are now rates already calculated for the interstellar radiation field. And you see that's they vary a little bit from molecule to molecule. Most of them are actually very rapid. If you convert it to a lifetime, you get to a much like 10 years or so. Meaning that molecule like C3 falls apart in 10 years in the interstellar medium, unless you reform it very quickly in dynamical reactions. So that's sort of gives you a mindset that on astronomical timescales this is very fast. And so you better reform it, or you need to shield your molecules completely from dissociation in order to make them. But we know that we see these molecules when they are exposed to intense radiation fields. So that is an issue that we then need to address. So of course with Alex, we always did theory, but the obvious answer question is always, why don't you use experiments? And experiments, there have been plenty as well, but one problem is that they're always limited to the stable molecules. Anything you can buy in a bottle, that's fine, but the moment you start to talk about a radical or an ion or one of these weird carbon molecules, then it's hard to produce enough of them in the laboratory for a long enough time to do a proper absorption experiment over the full wavelength. So you can go to the literature and you can find absorption cross-sections of many stable molecules. In fact, a lot of them still date from the time of the 1970s. After that, lasers came, and people have been doing lots of detailed studies at 157 nanometers, so you can find lots of data in the literature on 157 nanometers or 193 nanometers. But that's just one wavelength. We really need. So it's wonderful now to see the synchrotron facilities actually coming online, because, well, already being online for sort of a decade now, because the synchrotron, of course, has the wide wavelength range, and there you can again get sort of the kind of data that we need for astronomy. They can have very high accuracy, especially if the absorption is continuous. But there's a big warning that anytime you go into one of these discrete narrow lines, then experiments can be way off unless you fully resolve the bands. This was a very important point that was made here at the CFA by Yoshino, Peter Smith, and Dan Stark, that kept saying this warning that don't trust any of the measurements unless you have the bands fully resolved. And certainly for carbon monoxide, it turned out to be a very important lesson. Experiments also only measure the absorption. You need to separately measure fluorescence or ionization to determine really the dissociation cross-section. So again, not every absorption leads to a dissociation, so you need to take that also into account. So here are just some examples of experiments. Here is water. Nice continuous spectrum, well known. Here is nitrogen oxide, not so well known. Here is CH4, which has again a broad absorption but also fluorescence. So again, we need to wonder whether all of these absorptions lead to dissociation. That's again an example. So this is just the absorption. Then you also need to know the products. OH can go to many levels, and this actually leads to the red line of oxygen, for example, or the green line of oxygen. And these products may actually depend on your radiation field. Triatomics, whether water goes to OH or to oxygen, is also important in models. But it certainly produces energetic hydrogen, and that's, for example, what has been seen here in this escaping hydrogen from an exoplanet atmosphere. Polyatomics, we're still very much in the dark as to even cases like CH4, but we produce mostly CH3 or CH2. Methanol is a well-known case, both in the gas and in the ice. And so there are still lots of work available in there. Now we go even one step up in the complexity of molecules. We go from small molecules to large molecules, and now I'm thinking of the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. What is actually happening there? Well, there again we absorb into an excited state, and now this state has such a high density of states that you actually, through a process called internal conversion, you can actually couple with one of the other states. And then you're sort of on this multi-dimensional landscape in which you can find, sometimes you can find an exit towards a dissociation. To dissociation. Not always, but in some cases does. It becomes almost a statistical theory in order to determine whether the molecule dissociates or not. And this is the kind of theory that has been applied to, for example, PDHs for their dissociation. And so you can use this theory to calculate, for example, the stability of a PAH against the radiation field, against carbon loss, or against hydrogen loss. This is important for protoplanetary disks, where we see these PAHs and where they can actually be sort of the source of a lot of the carbon chemistry that we see there. And we can show already that the large PAHs, that only the large PAHs will survive in the inner regions of protoplanetary disks. Okay, so let's pause here for a second and invite some questions or comments on how well we actually understand these basic processes. I mean, what do we need? What do astronomers need? What are the challenges for the theorists? Who would like to add something? Yes.
So we were talking about PAHs, which I think are normally referred to more generically. Do you work on a particular exact model in the calculation, or do you have a purely statistical model?
Atoms and then sort of the typical binding energies that you work with. It's not like you're really having sort of core ring versus some other version with an equal number of carbon atoms.
it does start to matter when you have also not just aromatic moieties, but also, say, aliphatic, so CH strain change attached to it, and it starts to become important.
Do we have a sense of how big these molecules are, the ones that are actually exerting?
Oh, yes, yes. We think they are of the order of 100, 50 to 100 nanometers. Too large, they don't emit any more these specific features. Too small, they don't survive the photo associations.
Yeah. For the smaller molecules, the effect of baryonic couplings gets pretty damn large for, like, C3 and whatnot. It's things like Renatella coupling.
Yeah.
Do they affect the photo dissociation rates a lot?
I know. I mean, those are the kind of couplings that for the triatomics we have indeed tried to take into account, but calculations rapidly get very complex. So they are important in whether you can find a pathway to your dissociative channel. And that's why you need to take that into account, yes. Anybody else? Any wish lists? Okay, good. So just one comment still on the accuracy. This is actually our compilation with all of the molecules that we looked at. And these are the present rates, and these were the previous 20-year-old versions. And these is from a completely independent database that was used for commentary atmospheres. And it's sort of interesting to see sort of the accuracy. So this is from the molecules which dissociate fastest to the ones that dissociate slowest. So most of the ions like HCO plus or OH plus are at very slow rates, relatively slow rates. Something like CS2 or carbon C4 at very high rates. But it's, you know, we've tried to give as good as possible estimates of the accuracy of these processes. And in some cases we know that they are uncertain by an order of magnitude. In other cases, they are sort of at the level of say 30% to a factor of 2, which for most astrophysical applications is fine. You see here some of the sort of cases where you have large changes over the years. Okay, good. A little bit about radiation fields. All right, so here is the wavelength scale, in this case in nanometers. Here is the hydrogen ionization potential, 912 angstroms, going into 2000 angstroms. And basically on this scale, which is many orders of magnitude, the X-star radiation field is pretty flat. It's the peaks that are sort of in the far UV, but it is pretty flat. If you take a young star, like Tellurian Hydra, sources with a protoplanetary disk around it. Then you see again, it's pretty flat on this scale, but with some very structured emission lines. It's most notably Lyman alpha, which is then becomes then very important in the association. Now let's look at the sun. The sun looks on this scale like this. So of course, brighter here in the long wavelengths, but greater at the short wavelengths. And this is another version, now there's even more in there, so here's the sonar radiation field again, 4,000 kilobyte body now going out to 4,000 angstroms, so they're going into the visible. So here's the sonar radiation field, this is a cool star. So of course we have now disks around N-type stars, and the radiation field looks something like 4,000 kilobyte body. On the other hand, if you're a Herbig star, then you would be at 10,000 kilobyte body. This is the interstellar radiation field. And again, here's Lyman alpha. That's an important specific wavelengths range. So it really depends on where your molecule peaks. So this is the most important range. And like the hydrogen, CO and N2, three of the most important interstellar molecules, are all here in this tiny range between 9-12. So they really use these photons. So this is very important for radiation fields. This is a comparison of some cross sections. So here is water again, very, very broad over here, and then becoming structured at the shorter wavelengths. organic molecules, this is molecular nitrogen, very structured, all at a short wavelength. So you see already it depends very much on your molecule, which part of this radiation field is important to determine the rates. So you really need to know both. Some of them overlap as Lyman alpha, others do not. That is also important to know. Even more structured is the cosmic ray induced spectrum that we have detailed side clouds. So this is the process that was put forward by Prasad and Raftai. I think actually it was discussions with Alex also at the time. A survey then picked up by Alex in the papers, a series of papers that he wrote with Gredo on the Poland Institute in the CFA. So basically, you excite, you ionize molecular hydrogen that creates an energetic electron. That energetic electron basically excites molecular hydrogen, and then you emit basically through the same line in the order systems, and you get this whole series of lines. It is the weak continuum indicated here by the least. This is the weak continuum that Alex calculated already in the 1970s. So this is then the part that you have to evolve with your cross sections. So you see the challenge of getting a high resolution. Interestingly, if you look at the lamp, the typical lamp in your laboratory, this is actually what it looks like. So it very much resembles this cosmic ray induced spectrum, except that usually in the laboratory you have a cutoff at magnesium fluoride, you have the windows, so you're not putting up this short wavelength. And then you can tune your lamp such that you have more or less of the Lyman alpha actually in your laboratory spectrum. So this is not a bad representation of what is happening deep inside the clouds. Of course, deep inside the clouds, the radiation can also be attenuated by the grains. And this, how much that attenuation is, depends on your grain properties. For normal 0.1 micron size grains, it is quite severe, the extinction. If you make your grains bigger, as we now know is happening, in, say, in protoplanetary disks, then your attenuation is much less. And again, you can calculate that for each of these species. The molecules can also shield themselves. And again, Alex has done some very fundamental work on this, especially with the molecular hydrogen. Where the molecules basically themselves absorb so much of the radiation that's lying at the edge of the cloud that the molecules that lie deeper inside the cloud are actually shielded from this dissociated radiation. And then you can have a lot of fun because molecular hydrogen can shield CO, CO can shield N2, and so you have all of these lines all between 912 and 1100 angstroms that can shield each other. Show that in two examples at the end. Here is just a COH2 shielding example. So now detailed spectroscopy zooming in around 1,000 angstroms. Here you have two bands of carbon monoxide that are important in the photodissociation. And here is the spectrum of molecular nitrogen. So you see this band here is completely shielded by molecular hydrogen. This band, on the other hand, is at the beginning of the molecular hydrogen spectrum. And so it's not so important. The CO, it gets even more fun, because you have 12 CO, you have 13 CO, you have 12 C17O, you have 12 C18O, you have 13 C17O, you have 13 C18O, so. And then we, with this retwister, we try to simulate all of them, and again, we get into a lot of details as to which one is shielding actually which. The laboratory spectroscopy this is still going on. So people like Landstar are still spending a lot of time at the synchrotrons to figure out these isotopes because they are still important for the astronomy. There's lots of questions about isotopes, also that you find in meteorites, the 17O, the 18O, that are really probably at the origin due to the isotopes of the photodissociation. So this is still an area of research. And then when you go deep inside the cloud, you know, 12 CO is shielded earlier than, say, 13 CO, 18 CO. And you get this characteristic EVR structure that Alex also worked on so much, especially with Emil Sternberg, where you go basically from the HH2 to the slow transition. Okay, good. So, another few questions. Radiation fields. How well do we know them, and when does it really matter? Who wants to say something about them? Yeah.
So, yeah. Now, a question about the self-shielding. Is there, are there sustainable self-shielding modes, or are they necessarily erosive? Is your shielding through photon-induced dissociation? Unless you recreate that molecule, aren't you going to gradually eat away into the
You mean the ones at the edge? Yep. Basically, they absorb the photons, and yes, yeah. But you basically reform them, of course, also.
There are state balance.
Yeah, it's certainly true. It's certainly true that when you get into a time-dependent PDR, for example, advancing dissociation front or something like that, then you can get funny effects. But normally, basically, that's included in the reformation that you then recreate the H2 molecules again. Yeah?
I have a question. When you talked about the effectiveness of cell shielding from going from 12C all the way to C8, you know, how much of that is due just to the column density difference, the abundance difference, and how much is due to the structure of the
That's a good point. I think most of it is due simply due to the abundance difference. Yeah. And certainly in the case of CO dust, it's also still important. But you can have these funny effects that, you know, for one isotope log can really make a difference. For example, we found one for 12C7 that very, very made a difference, one of these coincidences.
But most of it's just abundance.
Most of it's, yeah. I think the zeros order, the zero and first order effect are the abundance, and the second order effect is the regional shielding.
Usually, when we try to model these regions, we assume some knowledge of the radiation field, which is often a big unknown in these models. How close are we to being able to use molecular data itself to infer the radiation?
Ah, that's a good point. I wouldn't, given some of the structures that we see both in the cross sections, that would be a little hesitant, but that's a good point. I think with Lyman alpha, you could make some attempts, because we know quite accurate for some molecules that absolutely not associated by Lyman alpha and others that are. So that is important. I think also this 912 to 1100 angstrom, actually to the extreme ultraviolet, so to say, that's where we know the least. And we've been trying to use the abundance of CO to say something about that.
Yeah, I have a tangential question. So you mentioned the 17-nanometer and like the Ehrlich's comment. Yeah. What's your intuition on how much of that is like the photosynthesis versus differences in 0.1 energies when it comes to
studying those isotopes? I think actually for the 17-nanometer, 18-nanometer, I think it's mostly photosynthesis, because I don't see enough in the energy, the temperature difference. For 12C, 13C, yes, I see the temperature playing a role, but 17-18-nanometer, and also the 14-nanometer, 15-nanometer, that will hopefully get to in a second. I don't see enough temperature effects. All right, so speaking about temperature, this is actually an interesting point. This is a brand new paper from Bernal et al. Because, of course, we mostly in our database, it's all low temperature we get. But when you get to an exoplanet atmosphere, which has CO2, then actually, whether you start from the ground vibrational state or from a higher vibrational state, actually does matter in this tail of this cross section. So this is a logarithmic scale. So normally in the interstellar radiation field, you're completely dominated by this part of the cross section. In exoplanet atmospheres, you're completely dominated by this part of the cross section. And now it starts to make a lot of difference whether you have sort of these high temperature cross sections or low temperature cross sections. So here is sort of the effect for a warm Neptune, as they call it, an 800K atmosphere, where these are sort of the differences. Now this is a percentage abundances, but then log scale, so so this is, I think, a factor of 10 to the 3 then. So it can make quite a difference as to what you actually assume for your cross section. So you have to watch out when you go to high temperatures like exoplanet atmosphere or Titan's atmosphere or something like that, then temperature effects start to All right, a few words about ISIS. I was not going to say much about it because Karen is clearly the person to talk more about this. We wrote a beautiful review about what that does, but I just want to say a few words about this because there are some differences with the gas phase. First of all, your absorption shift actually, because the environment in which your molecule is not exactly the same as the gas phase. It feels the surroundings of all these other molecules. And so here's the gas phase absorption of water, the first absorption event that is so important. This is actually where the ice is actually shifted to monomeric ice. And so we have done some simulations of this with molecular dynamics, and there are also compilations of this from experiments, actually very nice experiments by two different groups. So keep that in mind. Oh, that's just when you have an ice layer, that's sort of two molecules layer, that's called my layer. So the top layer and then the second and the third my layer, two layers of molecules in there. So basically, so it even depends on the details as to where the photon prints into the ice. This is a nice example. I took two of them, methanol and O2. So the blue is the gas phase. Sometimes highly structured, as in the case of methanol. The ice, much flatter, as you see over here. And again, so much. So be careful in just applying, you know, rates for the gas blindly to the gas. On the other hand, we don't have as much information on the ice, so we have to start somewhere. So here are some differences between the gas and the ice, shifts, plus modifications in the cross sections. But this is, I think, the most important one. Recombination basically of the products in the gas. I mean, when you do it in the gas, the two particles can just freely fly apart and you will never see each other again. But in the ice, the environment is dense enough that you can actually they can recombine again. Or they can recombine with other fragments. So the photo destruction rate is actually much less than the photo dissociation rate. It can be orders of magnitude less. And but on the other hand, that is also what's creating new complexity. That's what leads to the new molecules, including the very complex molecules. In fact, in the ice, it doesn't matter so much whether you do it with UV or whether you break the bonds by ions or any other form of energetic processes. The outcome is actually not so different, except the one difference is whether or not you are able to break carbon monoxide and two bonds, which are two of the very strongest ones, which usually you are not able to break with UV in the lab, which you are able to break this ion bonds. So that is an important aspect. So this is from one of Karen's seminal papers, where she just started with methanol, and then looked over the fragments, H2OH, O3H3, CH3. And you see here already that there are recombination of all of these species who create many of the complex molecules that we actually see in space. And then we'll talk about it on the first day, like dimethyl ether that you have here, and ethanol, etc. Okay, so that was a very brief part about ice versus gas, but who wants to add something to that? Still an enormous amount of work to be done here, yes.
On the slide where you showed the absorption spectra of water and ice, where you had the three multiple bilayers, is there a reason why the gas phase spectrum is red shifted from the solid phase?
Yes, there is. I can try to recall what the argument was, but yeah, it has to do with the electronic states and the interaction that they feel. But I was surprised. I had expected it to redshift, but it's actually blue shifted, and instead what you see systematically in the experiments. Yeah.
I was just going to maybe this is a
better lecture term, but photodesorption is a very important process, not an initial one here. There's the making of these molecules in the ice, but then the different cross sections and energies needed to get it off of the ice.
Yes, so that's the one slide that I skipped because I'm going to show that on Wednesday. Actually, I decided to put that with the water story. So I'm happy to talk more about it. But yes, that's because indeed a fraction of the molecules in the top layers can basically, fragments can escape from the ice. And then you have photodesorption, or the molecule can escape intact. That's all this.
Yeah. You have to find those devices.
Yes, which I'm going to talk about on Thursday, I think. But which is not easy. But yes, JWST can give a good shot at it in finding the O2Is. That's yes, good. All right. So in the last 10 minutes, I want to say still a little bit more about N2. And actually, a lot of this story started in Titan's atmosphere. So Titan is, of course, an example of. Chemistry that is a very dense atmosphere, much denser than that we have in the H7 medium. So this is a little bit in between the gas and the ice, in the sense that the fragments can also recombine here and lead to what is called photochemistry. The term photochemistry in chemistry usually implies that fragments following the dissociation are actually reacting at these molecules in the excited state. So it's, we have to be a little bit careful with that. The word photochemistry, it's not exactly the same as photodissociation. Any case, Titan's atmosphere, you start with basically molecular nitrogen and CH4, which you have in the other atmosphere. You have the solar radiation fields, then you try to break molecular nitrogen and methane, and that creates an enormous soup sort of carbonaceous molecules. So this is already a very rich source, actually, of many of these carbon-bearing molecules. And something like this may also happen, actually, in the inner dense regions of the protoplanetary disks. Maybe we have a similar situation. But the reason that I put this slide in front of the isotope selective photon dissociation is that the puzzle of 49-59 actually started actually in this atmosphere, in Titan's atmosphere. And then the sort of it was transported also to the interstellar medium. And this is something that was not just known in Titan, but that was also known in meteorites, that was known in comets, that was known in the interplanetary dust particles, IOPs, namely that the 49-59 ratio is not what is found in Jupiter, which is supposed to be the original primordial value, not the Earth value. Actually enriched in 59, so a lower 49-59 ratio. And in fact, here the CFA, Viviane Guzman, and Karen have looked at the number of 49-59 disks. There are other groups like Paolo Caselli, who has been looking at the cold gas. And then here are the comets, and you see that in all of these regions you find sort of an enrichment in nitrogen. So the question is really, is this due to low temperature chemistry, especially here at the cold course, people are promoting that, that it was low temperature chemistry, or could this be actually due to isotopes and photon dissociation? Right, so here is actually the beautiful ALMA observations of the disk in the recent paper by Viviana. Here are two disks studied with ALMA, where you can observe both the 13 cm, so that's the thin version of ACM, and then it's 50 to determine this ratio of 49 over 50. So we set out to calculate properly the N2 photodissociation. But this just happened that I ran into at the right moment into Alan Hayes, who was an expert, at least his supervisor was an expert on molecular nitrogen, and he had by far the best model. And I said, okay, this is the moment to do N2 properly for interstellar purposes. So we did that, and in fact, it's incredibly complicated. These are the excited electronic states involved. And so, happening really next to 30.6, there are 5 electronic states. So we absorb into there, we again, you have to know all of these couplings between all of these states in order to do that. And what actually Alan Hayes and his supervisor, Brandon Lewis, did, he used exactly the method that Alex and myself had developed, coupled channels of equation in order to compute this. The result is that we now actually know molecular nitrogen better than carbon monoxide. I would say, and we've proven this with experiments, that we have quantified this to the 20% level, both for 14N and for 14N2 and 14N15N. So it was a lot of work, especially by the molecular physicists, also experimentalists like the Lubachs in the Netherlands. They really spent 2 decades of work in the laboratory, but I think we now know this is actually very well. Good, so then you can, once you have a model, you can put it in a disk, and that's what we discussed just now. Here's the gas density, here's the radiation field that goes into the disk, and this is then what you get for 14N or 15N. So this is the N2 ratio, N2 of the 14N, 15N, and you see here that there's a layer in the disk where 15N is more dissociated than 14N2, and that's why you have certain excess of 14N2 and a drop of the 14N2 to 15N. So this is a higher ratio of 14N to 15N. It's yellow. Blue is basically when you have the opposite. So now here I make HCM. I have in this layer I have more 15N available, and so I'm making more HC15N in this layer of the disk. And this also happens to be just a layer where most of the HCM is actually emitted. And so that is why we will enhance this. So if you look at the effect of the column density ratios, then if you don't have any effect for precipitants and photon dissociation, you have your value over here for 40. And then when you include the isotopes that photon dissociation as a function of radius, this is what you get. This is where the observations lie. There are 2 caveats here. One is where you chart start is 440, or where you start is 270. If you start is 270, you get exactly into this observed ratio. The other is that this is column density ratios and not emission ratios, so you can also still to correct for that. Since, again, the biggest effect is just in the emitting layer here, where the H15N is. Okay, so that is just one example of, you know, the level of details that you have, where we really are using the facts that we have 20 years of laboratory data. And one very bright postdoc that can put it all together into a model that astronomers can actually use. And then now we have the model that we can apply to any astrophysical situation. Right, so that is just one example. Any questions on isotopes about the photo dissociation at this
point? Let anybody else who has a question ask one about that. I'm intrigued by that talk that you just showed. Can that be used to set limits? If you go back to the disk, can that be used to set limits on the migration or non-migration of a planet like Saturn? This is presumably the ratio where the planet was formed, but not necessarily where it ends up later. So if a planet has a different nitrogen ratio today, could this result be used to infer that it was born somewhere else in the disk?
Well, that's an interesting case. So look at this. I mean, so generally I would say any effect that is at the level of 50% will be very hard to distinguish. But this is an interesting case that basically the outer disk, there is hardly any effect. So if it was really like in the HR 8799 planets, it was, they were formed really far out, then the effect would be minimal.
No, it was thinking more to the left.
To the left, yes. Yeah. You wish that the effect would be larger than this to make it work. But maybe
once we get to. And a broader question, and that is with just regard zooming out, do you regard as the lingering uncertainties that perpetually cause models of PDRs, different models of PDRs? PPRs to vary by, in some cases, orders of magnitude in their predictions of key diagnostic parameters.
Right, right, right. So I think it's not the chemistry, at least not of the simple molecules. I think it's the temperature structure. And that's really because the gas temperature is so hard to compute accurately in that sort of regime of 1,000 Kelvin. So any line that is sensitive, like the high JCO lines, like the hydrogen excitation lines, anything that is sensitive to temperature, that is the largest uncertainty. And it's very difficult to get it more accurate. It's the microphysics of photoelectric effect of dust grains, but even the inherent instability of the heating and cooling of that regime just makes it incredibly difficult. Yeah?
So from this plot, should I take away that the low temperature chemistry really isn't doing very much, at least in the disk environment?
Right, that's correct. And yes. Those are basically on top of each other.
Yes. Right. Yeah. It's a very even smaller correlation. And, if you applied these models to clouds, like how much can you get from the low temperature chemistry?
Well, we did also for the cosmic ray induced photons, the 14 and 15 and deep inside clouds, it's a very small effect on the 14 and 15 at the end. So what you need to have in the dark clouds is basically that you do the isotope selective photo dissociation at the edge, and then you bring sort of the enhancements, you bring it into the center of the cloud. That would work. But simply inside the center of the cloud, it's very difficult to get it. But it's also hard to get with just low temperature chemistry. So so a large fraction of that plot is still unexplained, unless indeed you bring in the material, you do the isotope selective photo dissociation at the edge, and
is that also how you think that you get it into a comet? Because of course, where you show that the ice cream was up towards the surface while the comet's forming in the plane. I mean, do you think that's happening in a disk?
That's a good point. We have to go back to the comets to see whether some of that, whether it's in the daughter products or whether it's in the parent product, the parent molecules. Yeah. It could be a difference. Okay, so I just would like to end here, a few minutes late, but I hope that I've shown you that photoreducible processes are important in many areas of astrophysics. Details do matter. Details matter a lot. We have made much progress. Of course, there's always more needed, but it's really, try to isolate the really important processes and then focus on them. Like the molecular nitrogen, that was lying there until 2013 to 2014 before we finally were able to attack it probably. This is, I think, the largest uncertainty at the moment, the photoelectric ratios. There's very little progress that has been made. New experiments are being set up to address this, but this has been where a lot of work is still needed. And then, of course, the subsequent chemistry data first, the real photochemistry data first, and it's I think really the fruitful interaction between astronomy. Alex so initiated, especially here at the CFA, I think that will continue. Thank you very much.
So, yeah, I don't know if there are more questions.
But it is, but N2 will not affect CO and H2 because it's a minor species compared to these other two. So in that sense, it's not important. It's more that molecular hydrogen in turn again affects N2, and CO affects N2. So in the end, we took all three of them together to calculate the Schumann.
About whether to be hopeful or not. Because it has to do with complexity, because there's so much work to do, mostly high-time molecules, or tri-time molecules. And then you can take a leap up into the polyatomic parts, 50 to 100. But in the discovery space of molecules, at least, vast numbers of molecules have been picked up, and it's mostly in the submillimeter, but intermediate.
Complexity. Yeah.
And is this sort of understanding basically almost permanently out of reach for you?
So, a lot of the details, yes, but most of those molecules are stable molecules that we can actually buy in a bottle and do experiments on. So that is the whole part that we don't have to understand all the details. We just need the high resolution measurements of it, and that's a lot easier. You don't have to understand all the little details and couplings between them. So I think that there is sort of a lot of straightforward work to be done there. It's not very difficult to do, but give us a lot of details.
Well, if there are no more questions, let's thank Jabine again. And 2 days for the next lecture on water.